Okay, today my talk is on biologics, which are used in psoriasis. You know, the biologics are being used in almost every disease which has an inflammatory etiology. So today this talk will be restricted mainly to the biologics which are being used in psoriasis, and a brief word about what are the biologics and how would you monitor the biologics. And I would like to acknowledge that in this lecture I have taken a few slides from a talk by Colonel Muniza Rizwan, which is HOD dermatology of PF Hospital Islamabad. So what are the biologics? Biologics means biotechnology, and these are the products of natural origin which are engineered from live specialized cells like bacteria, yeast, and hamster. They are large molecular weight complex proteins, and they act on surface of the cells. Usually all the biologics are given as injections. None of the biologics is available in oral formulation, and they modulate the immune response, augmenting or reducing by targeting specific immune molecules. So the specificity of this targeting is what the biologics are all about. So this is a very useful slide, and there are very difficult names for the biologics, and among the names there are a certain rules which, if you remember, you will understand few important things. If biologic is totally of a human origin, then a word U is added in the name. If it is a mixed human and mouse origin, then zoo or Z is added. If it is a reception fusion protein, then there will be sep in the at the end of the word. And the monoclonal antibodies, which most of the biologics nowadays are, there will be three words at the end, which are MAB, M-A-B. For example, adalimumab. That means adalimumab is a humanized origin monoclonal antibody. Etanercept is a reception fusion protein. Infliximab is a human and mouse origin monoclonal antibody. Again, eccesimab is a mouse and a human origin and is a monoclonal antibody. Secukinumab, which is the most commonly used biologics nowadays, is a human origin. It's a human origin, and is a monoclonal antibody. So just remember these few words, letters. So the monoclonal antibodies, these are the main type of biologics which are being currently used in psoriasis and other inflammatory diseases as well. Monoclonal antibodies are the proteins that specifically bind to the protein or the cell surface of cell surface in the circulation or in the tissue, and it alters the target proteins, thus altering the course of the disease. So these monoclonal antibodies are directed against those specific antigens, and rather than making a generalized sort of action, these monoclonal antibodies make a targeted action on the specific sites or specific cytokines, and thus resulting in a more profound effect, and in addition to that, lesser side effects. So the biological therapies in psoriasis include the tumor necrotic factor alpha inhibitors. These were the first biologics which were being used in psoriasis. There are different kind of tumor necrotic factor alpha inhibitors, Cimeza, which is sertolizumab, and Enbrel, which is etanercept, Humira, which is adalimumab, These are the two commonly used, that etanercept and adalimumab, and then Remicade, which is infliximab. In psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis, there is excess production of tumor necrotic factor alpha in skin or joints that leads to rapid growth of skin cells and or damage to joint tissue. So by blocking the tumor necrotic factor alpha production, it helps stopping this inflammatory cycle of the psoriasis. Then interleukin 12 and interleukin 23. These are the new biological therapies which are being evolved. And the only one drug which is used is Stelara, which is ustekinumab. And you know that both these cytokines are derived from activated antigen-presenting cells. Then interleukin 17. Interleukin 17 is secreted by TH17 receptor, TH17 cells. And there are three interleukin 17 inhibitors. The first is Cosentyx, which is secukinumab. This is commonly being used in psoriasis nowadays. Then another interleukin 17 receptor inhibitor is 17 inhibitor is TALTS, which is ischikizumab, and then is brodalumab, which is blocks the interleukin 17 receptor A, through which the interleukin 17 mediates the inflammatory and immune response. T cell inhibitors, these are no longer used. Interleukin 23 inhibitors. These are the new evolving biologics and are being increasingly used and you know that interleukin 23 is secreted by antigen presenting cells, and interleukin 23 stimulates the production of TH17 cells, which produce the interleukin 17 A and F and other cytokines that would result in keratinocyte proliferation. So these are the different biologics which inhibit interleukin 23. So just this diagram I showed you yesterday, but there is a little improvement in this diagram. You see, these are the antigen presenting cells which are interacting with the naive T cells. As a result of this interaction, the antigen presenting cells are secreting two cytokines, interleukin 12 and interleukin 23. Interleukin 12 result in proliferation and secretion of activated TH1 and TC1 cells, which then migrate to the epidermis, migrate to the dermis, and release tumor necrotic factor alpha, interferon gamma, and other interleukin 6 and 1, and would result in keratinocyte proliferation. So this TH1, as it secretes the tumor necrotic factor alpha, so the etanercept, infliximab, and adalimumab would block this action, this tumor necrotic factor alpha secretion. And the other cytokine which is secreted by the antigen presenting cell is interleukin 23. And as I told you yesterday, this interleukin 23 would result in activation and proliferation of TH17 cells. So this step, this interleukin 23 step, is being inhibited by interleukin 12 and interleukin 23 inhibitors, like ustekinumab and these other biologics. And once the TH17 cells entered the epidermis, it result in secretion of interleukin 17A. And there are interleukin 17 inhibitors, that is cunicumab and ixekizumab, These are interleukin 17 inhibitors and brodalumab. So this is where these biologics are acting in psoriasis. The biologics are not the first drug which is to be used in psoriasis. If the psoriasis is associated with the arthritis, the best combination nowadays is combination of a tumor necrotic factor alpha, that is infliximab or etanercept, with methotrexate. If psoriasis is without arthritis and it's a limited disease, we can get away with using the topical therapies or targeted phototherapy. But if this does not have any effect, then we have to resort to the UVB or UVA therapy, oral and systemic agents like methotrexate, like acitretin, like cyclosporin, or biologics. But in case of extensive disease, you can consider using biologics from the start if the patient has already used the other systemic agents in psoriasis. These are the different biologics which are and were used. There are two drugs which are alfacept and eflusinib. These two drugs are now withdrawn in 2011 and 2009 respectively. But etanercept, which is a tumor necrotic factor alpha agent, infliximab and adenimumab, these are being used and more effective in psoriasis with arthritis. So these are the different doses in which these drugs are used. You don't have to remember the doses. Just remember that these are all injectable therapies. Ustekinumab, which is interleukin 23 inhibitor, available with the name of Stelara. This is not currently available in Pakistan, but is being used in America and in European countries. Secukinumab, which is available in Pakistan and which we are using, is an interleukin 17 inhibitor. It is given as subcutaneous injection. The recommended dose is 300 milligram on week 1, 2, 3, 4, followed by 300 milligram every 4 weeks. But it's my personal experience and the experience of other consultants in Pakistan, we are able to treat our patient with 150 milligram injection. So it comes in 150 milligram injection, which cost about 50,000 rupees. So if we give this 150 milligram injection on week 1, 2, 3, 4, and then after every 4 weeks, it is reasonably effective. Usually these all biologics, they make a very wonderful combination if they are used with methotrexate. So if methotrexate has no other contraindication, so it is better to prescribe all the biologics with methotrexate. This is the patient eligibility criteria for biologics. So every patient is not to be placed in biologics. The main concern is definitely the cost, and secondly, the potentiation, the possibility of aggravating the hidden infections or tumors because of biological therapy. In order to place a patient on biologics, the patient must fulfill the two criteria. Criteria A is the criteria of severe clinical disease and criteria B is one of the clinical criteria which I will explain you later. So severe clinical disease means that PASI score more than 10 or body surface area more than 10% or DLQI, which is quality and life index. The score should be more than 10. That means patient must be psychologically stressed or depressed. So even if the covered area is less than 10%, we can place that patient on biological therapy. So the clinical criteria include failure to respond or intolerant to standard systemic therapy, like PUVA, methotrexate, cyclosporin, repeated admissions, specific site causing disability like nail, genital, flexural face psoriasis, severe, unstable, or life-threatening disease, like erythrodermic or pustular psoriasis. Then psoriatic arthritis, eligible for treatment with anti-tumor necrotic factor alpha in association with skin disease. Can be, if any of these clinical criteria are fulfilled, then the patient can be straight away placed on a biological agent. This is important. Before placing a patient on biologics, the patient should be screened for tuberculosis and for hepatitis. Please apne aap ko mute kar lijiye. And patient should be screened for tuberculosis and for the hepatitis B and hepatitis C. So for screening of TB, the most valuable test is QuantiFERON gold test. You give blood and you do this QuantiFERON gold test. You want to test and chest X-ray is not required. So just order QuantiFERON gold test, and if the test is negative, you can be sure that patient is not suffering from tuberculosis and can be placed on biologics. Repeat the test if patient on biologic come in contact with a TB patient, and repeat the test if develop any symptom of the disease while on active care. So initially we should order this test before placing on biologics, and secondly, if the patient on biologic come in contact with a known tuberculosis patient, or if the patient develops symptoms of tuberculosis. No live vaccine is given during therapy and 6 months post therapy. The cytokines which are being targeted by the biological therapies, these are the cytokines which are used in arresting many infectious diseases, many viral infections, many bacterial infections. That is the reason that once you are targeting those cytokines, you are also hampering or restricting the biological defenses against these infections. So it is very important that the patient on biologics should not be made at risk of any of such infection. So no live vaccines, and given even to infants up to 6 months of age whose mother have received biological therapy beyond 16 week of gestation. So that is important, that the effect of biologics can last for such a long period. No biological therapy for 12 months in case of herpes zoster vaccine. Biological therapy can be started 4 weeks after administering of a live vaccine. Side effects. In addition to aggravation of these infections and reactivation of TB, there is risk of malignancies like melanoma and non-melanoma skin cancers and lymphoma. There can be infusion reactions, especially infliximab. These infusion reactions include pruritus, flushing, hypertension, and headache and skin rashes, and serum sickness-like condition. With other biological agents like Cosentyx, these reactions are very rare. So, monitoring of biological agents. These are the baseline tests, and these are the tests which are done later on. And for a baseline test, we order the complete blood count and comprehensive metabolic panels, which include lipid profile, uric acid, diabetes, thyroid, then QuantiFERON, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV. Optional and anti-nuclear antibody. So these are the basic baseline tests you should all remember. Whenever you will be asked encounter a patient of psoriasis or any other agent in which biologics are used, you will be asked about what are the tests you will order as a baseline investigations, and what are the tests you would do after the patient is on biologic. So the monitoring will be done by repeating complete blood count 2 to 3 months. At 2 to 3 months, and then every 6 to 8, 12 months. And comprehensive metabolic screening in same way. And this gold quantiferon or hepatitis B or hepatitis C on yearly basis. Treatment failures to biologics. There can be primary failure. As I was telling you yesterday, the cause of treatment failure may be there are other inflammatory mediators which are more prominent in that particular patient. It could be a secondary failure, which could be loss of efficacy with time and development of anti-drug antibodies. Since biologics are not a very old treatment, so many of these effects are being learned as we are increasingly using these biologics. So how would you manage the treatment failures? Dose escalation of current biologic. For example, I have started patient on 150 milligram of Cosentyx, and after 4 injections, the patient is not responding. So rather than changing Cosentyx, I should go to 300 milligram and then see the effects. It can be increased frequency of administration of biologics, addition of another treatment modality like a topical or phototherapy or conventional systemic therapy, and switching to some alternate biologics. These are the upcoming biologics which are interleukin 23 inhibitors. Then before ending this talk, I should introduce you two terms here. The first is generic and second is biosimilar. You know, when a drug is being developed in the West, the company, the organization, the pharmaceutical organization who is working on that drug has the proprietary right for that drug for a specific period of time, usually 10 years, because there is a lot of money spent on the research and development of that drug. So till that period is over, that is the period, for example, 10 years, no other company can make that biological agent. But once there is an end of that specific period of time, the 10 years or more, then the other companies can produce those biological agents, and the other companies will make the biological agents through the same method, same principles. But now these agents will be called as generics. So generics have usually no difference so far as the way of production is concerned and the safety profile of those biological agents. And usually the generics does not cost as much as the original brand, which is the research product. But still, the generics which have come in the market of those biologics which are a little older one are still very costly. So there are now another molecules which are in the market, and these molecules are called as biosimilars. Biosimilars are the larger and heavy complex molecules derived from living cells or organisms. There is a difference in complexity between biosimilars and generic and original drugs, which lead to its important distinction. The biosimilars use similar technology, but it is not necessary that they have all the similar ingredient as that of an original product. The production of biosimilars is definitely less costly. That's why they are emerging as the cost-effective alternates to biologics and have potential to make important biological therapies widely accessible to global population. So in Pakistan, we have now a few biosimilars available, which is being used especially in psoriatic arthritis. One of those biosimilars is infliximab, which is tumor necrotic factor alpha inhibitor. Usually infliximab is no longer used in